So we're halfway through 2017 on a streak. I think we'll keep this going. So of course I asked you guys on Twitter what you guys wanted to know from the past month. And of the thousands of replies, I can already say probably half of them were again about the OnePlus 5. Now I did publish the full review, so if anyone has any questions, a lot of them that you were asking could be answered by watching the full review, but there were some small updates. So there were a few controversial things about the OnePlus 5, like camera performance, old screen, benchmark cheats, etc. What are my thoughts? So the camera performance and the screen, those things were covered in the review, but the benchmark cheats were something that I found out about after I published my review. Apparently, OnePlus is still putting code in their OS that maxes out the CPU cores when it detects that a benchmark app is running. That is dumb. They clearly shouldn't have done that. I didn't use any benchmarks in my review, but people who did kind of got hit for that. My bottom line there is, yeah, it's dumb. They shouldn't have done it, and they should have stopped doing it a long time ago. But also, it's 2017, why do people still care about benchmarks? If you're still basing your smartphone purchase decision off of how well a phone does on benchmarks, then I guess this does have a big effect on you, but I don't think we should be doing that anymore. Performance is already pretty damn good off the board, and you can take my comments about the fluidity of it and how well it actually works in real life over benchmark scores. So I wouldn't put too much stock in that. What are your thoughts on the iPhone 8 concepts, vertical cameras and Touch ID on the screen, etc.? Okay, so the vertical cameras and all the renders we've seen pointing to that being the way the next iPhone camera looks a little bit weird in the renders, but I've always said this, phones always look so much better in real life than they do in the renders. The renders of some of the past couple of my favorite phones, including this phone, including the Pixel, and I think the past Nexuses, they've all looked way worse in the renders, and then the phone actually comes out and you hold the hardware in your hand, and it's actually kind of nice. So I'm not so worried about the cameras and the way they look on the phone. What I actually am concerned about is the fingerprint reader location. A lot of the rumors are pointing to this big full-screened iPhone with a fingerprint sensor under the display, and I want that to be true so bad, but I've also never seen that implemented anywhere in any product. And I'm not saying that means Apple can't do it. I mean, they've done revolutionary first of its kind stuff in their products before, but I've just never seen a display with a fingerprint reader underneath it, under the glass, ever. So my fingers are crossed that Apple can do this and do it well the first time around, but I'm also not super optimistic, and I wouldn't be surprised to see a fingerprint reader around the back or up at the front again of the next iPhone. What do you think about the upcoming Note FE? This is actually a really weird thing to me. Samsung is going to be selling refurbished Galaxy Note 7s before the Note 8 comes out as the Note FE. Why? You would think with all the bad press about the Note 7 and all the problems they had with it, they would just completely abandon that project, put it to rest, RIP, tombstone and everything, just like let it go. And we even have the Note 8 like probably right around the corner, and maybe 2 months we'll see that phone. So a little bit confused about why they're coming out with Note FE. A refurbished Note 7 doesn't sound like the best idea to me. If you became the CEO of a tech company for a day, which company do you pick and what would you do? Okay, so hear me out. I think this is actually kind of a clever idea. I would be the CEO of Tesla for a day, which number one would let me like go into the office and just look at all the plans for Model 3 and Model Y and the semi truck and all the stuff they have planned for the future. That would be cool. But also that technically makes me the CEO of a rocket company also, and also the tunnel boring company. I get to see cool stuff about like the Hyperloop and all the other stuff they're planning. I feel like it would be kind of like a win-win-win-win. Since he's kind of a busy dude. When is USB Type-C going to take over? Apple definitely took the big major steps towards making USB Type-C much more popular, but I think once you see those accessories, it being a no-brainer that they get USB Type-C, that's when you know it's taken over. Is Apple iPhone 8 or X going to live up to the hype? No, nothing ever lives up to the hype. And that's not to say hype should die. Okay, hype is just marketing. It happens a lot with a lot of different companies. I'm just saying, nothing ever actually lives up to that hype. Why don't you do vlogs? I'd love to watch MKBHD vlogs. Okay, so the honest answer to that is, I've actually thought about this question in the past, and the answer is time. So the thing about making vlogs in addition to all the stuff I already make is it means I also then have to edit all that stuff in addition to what I'm already editing, which means it would take more time. And vlogs can be really cool. I've seen some really great ones, obviously, but I think if I were to do vlogs, most of them would end up just being behind the scenes of the main videos that you guys watch. So I think if you want to see that kind of stuff, you should follow me on Twitter, first of all, but also Snapchat and Instagram. I think that's a definitely more time-efficient way of sharing that stuff with you guys.
Trust me, I've thought about vlogging. It's just there's only 24 hours in a day, you know?
Next question is, why were you in France with Casey Neistat? Oh, speaking of vloggers, so if you saw Casey's latest video, the summer movie thing, if you saw the end of it, then of course you know it was shot entirely on Galaxy S8s. That I can verify is true. So there are lots of vlog shots and car shots and things that you could imagine would be shot with a normal handheld phone, but there's also plenty of drone shots and aerial shots and crazy angles, but those were also shot on a smartphone as well. It was with the help of a company called DroneWorks, and they were the ones that were responsible for putting Galaxy S8s in these custom rigs with cine lenses and massive drones and getting these incredible shots from this, technically the Galaxy S8's camera. Casey and Samsung invited me along to check out the whole thing, and I was super impressed with it. Obviously, it takes the whole shot on a smartphone thing to the next level. I'm open to like analyzing, like, really, how far do these pros go? Like, you've seen those shot on iPhone ads that Apple makes. How far do they really take those iPhones to be able to get those shots? You'd be curious about that. But anyway, that's why I was in France. Would you believe your eyes if 10 million fireflies lit up the world? Thoughts on Bixby's Beta 1. Okay, so I've talked a lot about Bixby in the past, so naturally people were curious about if I was impressed with the Bixby Voice update that's just coming out. There's an early access program. Bixby Voice is finally becoming available to some of those people, and you can download and install it and give it a shot. And it's pretty bad. I'm gonna link The Verge's video below where they did some testing of it. They asked it some questions. To be fair, it does have some abilities that Siri and Google Assistant and Cortana don't have, meaning it can dig into an application and do commands from inside apps. But you can tell from the video, it's super slow. It doesn't get all the questions right. It doesn't always understand you. And also, this was part of the video.
Who's the president of the US?
Lots of sunshine today.
Well, couldn't have gotten that much wrong.
So long story short, Bixby has a long way to go. Surprise, surprise. Good luck, Samsung. Tesla versus Faraday Future. Okay, so anytime you compare a Tesla with anything else, like Faraday Future or Lucid Air or any of the companies that don't even really exist yet or are selling electric cars, I've always said, even if you make a car that's incredible, every bit as good as the Tesla, even better in every single way, it's still not really gonna sell well. Because Tesla already has the mind share and already has the sex appeal that these cars don't have yet, just in the way people think about car brands. And then they also have the infrastructure. They already have the supercharging network. They make it really easy to drive electric cars long distances that those other companies don't have yet. So it's always funny to see an article labeling something as like a Tesla killer. There is not gonna be a Tesla killer for a very long time. In the same way that there's not gonna be a Ford killer, because that's just part of the industry now. And there's also definitely enough space for Tesla and other companies to exist in the electric car market. There's no Tesla killers yet. Demographically, where do you have the largest following? Okay, so once we got this question, we actually looked into it a lot, and there's some really interesting stats about the MKBHD channel viewership, all of you guys. So if I go into YouTube analytics, I can check out which countries have the most people watching. USA, number one, India, number two, United Kingdom, number three, Canada, Australia, Germany, and then the list goes on. But then we actually sorted by population size of that country, at least on the first page, so we could tell who had the highest viewership per capita in a way. So shout out to Singapore and Sweden for topping that list. And then of course there's a male-female demographic. Turns out we're at a study 95% male, 5% female, ladies. And something I also had to sort just to find out, if you look at all subscribers and unsubscribers from a channel in the lifetime of it, the MKBHD channel, and I'm almost proud of this, in its lifetime has lost almost 1 million subscribers since its inception. We should get a plaque for that. That's kind of impressive. 900,000 plus people have decided, you know what, that's enough, I don't wanna say anymore. But also that means that the 4.7 million subscribers the channel has now is just the people who have stuck around. There's also a couple hundred thousand more who subscribed and unsubscribed. It's weird. I'd be curious if that's a common ratio or number for YouTubers in tech or even in other genres, or if that's even weird to talk about that, I don't know. But either way, I'm gonna end it there. Thanks for all your questions. I hope this was a fun Q&A, and hopefully you enjoyed seeing a little bit of a different part of the studio. This is Studio B. But we're gonna be right back on it with tech videos very shortly, because there's a lot of stuff coming out and a lot of stuff you guys have to see. Thank you for watching, and I'll talk to you guys in the next one. Peace.